Hey everybody, I'm Frank Bello from Anthrax at my Heart Key Clinic with Emmelie here. Make sure you watch her YouTube show, She Rules.
Hey, what's up guys? It's Emmelie and welcome to a new video. Today it's Saturday the 25th of February and I've got a very exciting story to share with you guys. Last weekend on Sunday I went to see ANTHRAX live with their Among the Kings tour, which was very cool. I wasn't planning on vlogging that weekend, but on Saturday I found out that Frank Bello from ANTHRAX was doing a base clinic in a town near where I live. I found out really late, actually an hour before the whole thing started. I immediately signed up and luckily I wasn't too late for that. So I went to the music store where the event took place and it was really interesting. Even if you're not a bass player, because I'm not a bass player, I play guitar if you didn't know already. His clinic wasn't focused on playing bass and showing off how good he was, but he was talking about his experiences and he was trying to stimulate people to start playing any instrument, so I really liked that. He also played 3 songs and of course I took my camera with me and I filmed these songs and a part of the clinic itself. Afterwards, he was doing a signing session and he signed my vinyl record. I brought State of Euphoria with me. He spelled my name wrong, but it doesn't really matter to me. I also got a pick. We also filmed an intro for my YouTube channel, which is so cool. I'm so happy that he wanted to do that. He was actually very nice. He was really friendly and enthusiastic. Please give this video a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe so you will keep up to date on everything that I do in this channel. I will upload another ANTHRAX related video tomorrow, so stay tuned. Leave a comment down below and I will reply to it whenever I can. I really like to have conversations with you guys. I will insert the videos of the clinic in here. Enjoy watching.
If you guys don't know, I play in this band called Cool Shirt, ANTHRAX. It's a side gig. I only play on weekends, you know, weekend gigs. And tomorrow. The reason why I look like this, and I apologize for scaring all the kids here, we just had 5 in a row. Sorry, is that me? Okay. We just had 5 shows in a row, and if any of you guys come in tomorrow night, you'll see why. There's so much in this show. We do a first set of just newer ANTHRAX songs, and then Among the Living afterwards. It's very much a compact, crazy, insane show. That's why I'm so beat up. But there's nothing more I thought important than doing a clinic. By the way, this is my only day off. And so, I'm not doing that, I swear to God. I think it's important to do clinics, and especially in this world of video games. I live in America, I live in New York. I have a 10-year-old son. I've been very lucky in this music business to do it for 35 years. And it's hard because I'm only 21 years old, so it's very hard, as you can see. So I think it's very important to pass the torch to the younger generation, and quite honestly, for the older generations, fans that are afraid to pick up an instrument. It doesn't matter. You don't have to play bass. You don't have to play bass. You can pick up any instrument. If I can inspire anybody, if there's one person here, if I can inspire by something I said or did today by playing, to pick up an instrument of anything, guitar, bongos, whatever, flute, whatever you want to do, if you can do that, then I've done my job. That's all I want to do at this point in my life. The companies, I'm doing this Heartkey Clinic for Heartkey, the company, the amp company, of course, and they're a great company, and that's why I believe in them, and that's why I want to pass that forward to you. But more importantly is getting players in this next generation to me. It's really the lifeblood of music. And you guys don't know how talented you really are until you try it. I'm telling you, everybody in this room has a talent in music. You just don't know it. How many bass players do we have here? We unite. Yes. How many guitar players? Yes. Drummers. All right, we're working on it. How many singers do we have? Good. Ah! You know what it is? I kid the singers. Here's why. You have the guys doing all the work in the back, right? really, the real work, and the singers get all the glory. Yeah, right? They get the covers, they get all that stuff. I'm very lucky because I have Joey Belladonna. He's just the best singer. I love him, everything he does. But and he's also a very regular guy, so I can kid around with him. He's also a drummer, so he understands the rhythm aspect of it. But I think it's very important. Even in my clinics, you know what's funny? I do a lot of clinics around the world. I find that I do a clinic, and the next year I try to get bands together in the clinics. Like there's guitar players and some bass players and drummers that don't have anybody to jam with. What I'd like to do with this, I would like to see you guys, if you guys don't have people to jam with, how about exchanging some email numbers and just phone numbers and maybe jamming together? It's a really cool way, because at my next time around, when I come, people give me like CDs and of their new demo that they created for my clinic that they jammed. So if you guys, please, if you don't have people to jam with, how many people are in bands here? Ooh, see, this is the, yes, I love this. How many people want to get out of their bands and start new bands? Yes! See, what we're going to do for you today, we're going to find you a new band. A guitar?
Yes.
All right, we have a guitar player here. How many people need a new guitar player in their band? I saw some of the, see what's happening here? There are people that they're going to throw out, they don't know. And they're going to replace them with you later on. We'll do that later. But I can't, just so you guys know, I keep my clinics very light. I like to have fun. Have you ever seen a clinic? I don't know how many clinics you guys go to. I've seen clinics where the clinician is up there scaring people out of playing, where they can do every scale. Right? And the new player is like, right? And is terrified because they think they'll never do that. Meanwhile, you're supposed to inspire people to play. And see how much fun. Remember, it's playing music. It's not working music. We're fortunate enough to play music. It's supposed to be fun, right? And that's the most important thing. I got into music when I was young because it was fun. I liked having the ability, even if I could play one note, I want that ability to take it day to day and learn more and more. And I think everybody here, if you haven't played yet, you can. And that's my whole point. So I know I talk a lot, and you guys have to tell me if I talk too much, because I just like connecting with people. I'm going to play a song for you now. You probably have heard it before, most of you. And what I like to do is make you see me playing to the track, and you see the bass stuff that that I've done in the past that you probably heard on the record that you didn't know was there. And if you have any questions about how I did it or even how to approach that stuff, this is why I'm here. This is why I'm here, to take you through it. And look, and if any of you like to, I'd like to have somebody up here where I can put my bass on you and actually show you. It's very important to pass that along. So this is what I do. I'm a hands-on kind of guy, and I just want to have fun with it and just make people play something, all right? So this first song I'm going to play, what is the name of it? It's called Caught in the Mosh. You guys know that song? Okay, cool. So this, just so you guys know, and I should probably talk about Harkey a little bit more since it is a Harkey bass clinic. This is the rig I play with. Not the center, I don't play with these. These just look good here. But this Harkey rig right here, the 8x10s, and I have to say this, they're no longer making these 8x10s, but guess who has it? This store. This store has the very few left. So if you guys are interested in these, and I'll put these up against any of the so-called big amp companies out there and cabinet companies. These things are what I bring on every tour I do. Honestly, this is what I do. These are the ones that come out, and I have this setup, those two 8x10s, and I'll put them up against any, not to sound negative with anybody else, but they work. All I want to do is pass it along. I'm pretty much on the front lines doing this every, we're currently on a 2-month tour. I get 9 days off, and I go back out for another, 6-7 weeks again. So there you go. I work. These work. The LH10 1000 is, believe me, we were talking about this before. You cannot use all the power in this amplifier. You just can't. I can't turn it, we talked about this, we can't do more than three. In fact, you know what? I can't push it towards two. On the big stages, because then I get the look from the drummers. You know, the drummer, I get the guitar player, you know, the guys in my group. You know, you get the, dude, too loud, come on, I can't hear, you know? All right, lower down, so it's gotta go to two instead of three, right? But I'll start this thing off by playing Caught in the Mosh. If you guys can't hear, we can adjust the sound. We did a sound check before, but if you can't hear anything, you wanna hear something louder or softer, I'll do that too. But let's have some fun, right? Let's do it. All right, my bass. I'll talk about the bass later.
This is apple juice, right? Everybody knows I drink apple juice. I'm very healthy. Ah. All right, here we go. How's my hair? Look good? No, I'm kidding. All right, here we go. If this thing works, you guys know what this thing called an iPod is?
Yeah, it sucks.
I know it sucks, right? Sometimes it doesn't work. We're gonna see if it works. It worked before. Come on, baby. Yes!
This is called Lavash. There's a lot of people that want what you want because you have the drive. All of a sudden, they don't have the drive. That means you can't do it? No, you can do it, and you will do it. You're away, and everybody's out of the picture. Everybody, just that's, see, I remember, and this always goes back to me growing up. How did I grow up? I grew up in the Bronx, you guys know the Bronx, New York, and all that stuff. Some of you heard this stuff before and read this. I grew up in the Bronx, New York, and quite honestly, here's where my family situation, this is where music comes into play with everybody's family situation. My personal story is, I grew up with, I was the oldest of five children in my family. My dad, when I was 10 years old, decided to split forever. He just took off, never to hear from him. So he's a scumbag, right? He's a scumbag, doesn't take care of his kids. That's in my book, you're a scumbag if you don't take care of your kids. Long story short, he leaves, my mom's alone with five kids. I had no heroes. I had no heroes to look up to because he was, until then, you think your father would be your hero. So, you know what happens when you're 10? You start looking outside. Who could be my hero? You start searching. Guess who were my heroes? Bass players. Bass players were my heroes. So, and look, I got into Kiss, the band Kiss. You guys know Kiss, right?
Yes.
Awesome. They were the big show. I said, I want to do that. But then, more importantly, after that, when I started to play guitar and then switching. Hey, this is a funny story I gotta tell you guys. So I'm playing guitar. I used to, you know my drummer, Charlie Benanti? My drummer. We grew up together in the same house, in my grandmother's house. I grew up in that house. Thank God for it, really. Because my mother really couldn't afford to keep five kids and do all that, and she was overwhelmed. So I went to live with my grandmother where Charlie lived, where we're related, where Charlie and I are related. So I lived in that house, and we used to jam at 13 years old, 14. And he noticed that while I was playing guitar, I was playing the bass parts on guitar, on rhythm guitar. So I just heard the rhythm of the bass more than the guitar parts. That's how I got into bass. He goes, why don't you just switch? Him and my friend Mike told me, just switch the bass. And then the day I switched the bass, it all made sense. It really all made sense. It's like, this is where, you know, this is where it's at. So then after that, who became my heroes? Again, a 10-year-old, well, it was 13 at that time. 13-year-old kid looking for heroes. I still, to this day, they're still my heroes. Steve Harris, Geddy Lee, Geezer Butler.
Yes.
To this day, that's not a bad group of people to have as heroes, right? Because they're consistent, right? They care about what they do, their craft, they build their craft, and I think they inspire a whole lot of people. How many people are inspired by those three bass players that are there? Even if you don't play bass, you just say, yeah, they're just awesome, right? So that made me, to this day, and it's great being friends with these guys now because I still look up to them. Like, in fact, when I'm with Steve Harris, he has to calm me down sometimes. because I'm still fanboy. Steve, still, so I asked him all these questions about, how did you do Killers? Like, is it like this? He goes, yeah, mate, I told you 10 times already, you know? But I don't think you should ever stop being a fan, right? I don't think, because without that hunger, without that drive, then you just get complacent and you don't want to grow. So when I talk to Geezer, I'll ask him about something in the Sabbath days. I said, what you doing that note? And he's like, why are you asking me these questions? He'll just, you know, because it's, he has to think. Imagine if somebody asked me about something way back. There's no memory anymore. I have no more memory. My memory's gone. But if I play it, I'll remember it. So on that song specifically, Caught in the Mosh, I'll go back to this. There's a lot of things going on in that you guys in the band will know this. When you play bass, you have to be careful to not go over the drums and not go over the vocals, not go over the guitar, and try to fit in what you want to fit in without taking over the song, right? So I would do something like the pre-chorus, where, which one of these words don't you understand? Now you see the scale, the little scale, it's a little ditty scale I just did right there, like da, da, da. That little scale, I call it an argument. It's an argument to get through to the next part, because if it's in the way, and it almost got in the way of the song, and you're writing the songs with other people, so everybody's got to agree on these parts. That was a little argument, but I got it in. Yeah, I won that one. I won that one. So you can't always win, though. You know, you guys write songs, right? People write songs in this. You cannot take over the song. So after a while, you know what to stick and move. But I think, even in the other part, I was doing this. So on the next one, another argument just to work it out. You had to make sure it fit within the song. Now the producer, Eddie Kramer, helped me on that one. He helped me win that one. I got that in, and there's no fighting or anything like that. Just, well, it doesn't work for the song. You really have to compromise. You really have to compromise when you're in a band. You guys know this, right? You have to pick and choose your battles. And in fact, it's all about the song. You guys, everybody knows that. It's all about the song. It's not a bass solo. It's not a guitar solo. It's not a lead vocal. It's all about the song. And then after a while, it's taken me a lot of years, but now I think I'm ready for that. You know, it's taken me a lot of years. So does anybody have any questions about that song? You guys want to know something from it? Because I'm all ears on it. I love showing people what they missed, or sometimes I get people that, what'd you do there? What'd you do there? Because I'm like that with Geezer and Steve. So not that I'm Geezer or Steve. I just, you know, I mean, Geddy Lee, for God's sake, there's just so much I want to talk to him about. There's just so much. But I'll get there. So anyway, I know I'm going back and forth with this. This is all where it comes from, that 1987. So that was a great time for Anthrax. We were upcoming, this thrash movement, and it was all good. I went back, you know, to my heroes. I went back. I was scared about the studio. Everybody, even to this day, I'm still intimidated a little bit about the studio. You know, I've been in a few studios in my life, but still going to the studio, it's the microscope. It's the microscope. So they're really looking at what you're playing and judging. When I go back to judging, you have to know your stuff. You can experiment. I like experimenting, but you cannot overplay. It's really important, you know. How many guys have overplay in the studio and then they get called back? I'm sure that happens, right? Yeah, it does. Yeah, haha, see? Especially you with the spiked head up there. You go for it. I can tell. You just look at your, I love that head. Is that a point? Or is that, let me see on the side. Dude, well done. Well done. Nice. So that's that era. But I'm going to go back into my next one. I'm going to give you a choice. I can go back to, you guys know this. You might not know this. Do you know Spreading the Disease?
Yes.
Oh, you guys do know that? Okay. Because sometimes I go back, you're not that old, you're that better. You know, this is, I could go back to this. I wasn't going to do it for you guys because I don't know if you know this, that record. But now I'm going into the whole intimidation factor about first time in the studio. Everybody has a first time in the studio, right? They're with the producer and stuff. Now, I'll play this song, and talking about my my roots and the players I looked up to, I didn't study bass. You know what I learned? I learned by listening to my heroes. I would learn before I get to the song, I got to tell you how this happens. I'll just go into it. This is how I learned. I have, you know what a record player is? Vinyl. You guys ever hear of this vinyl thing? In America, everybody's forgotten about vinyl, but it's finally coming back, but thank God for it, right? So I'd have a record player in my bedroom, and this is how I learned how to play bass. I would listen to my favorite bass players in their songs, and I learned nonstop. I would come home from school, I'd work in my uncle's deli, 7 o'clock, I come home, I sit down, and I just learned the songs I wanted to learn. I remember when Iron Maiden Killers came out. Remember, you know, guys know that record, right? Specifically, I couldn't wait till the day that record came out. It was the new Iron Maiden record, I got it. But I couldn't listen to it the night before because it was too late. I could listen to it the next day when I came home from school. Okay, I finished my work in the deli, I'm psyched. I said, yeah, I got that new Maiden record, I'm gonna learn that first song, Killers, I can't wait, right? And this is how I learned even how to do stuff on stage now, because I had my, you have to understand, you know, everybody has a bedroom, right? My bedroom was my Madison Square Garden. My bedroom was, there was thousands of people everywhere, right? In my mind. This is all my mind, because I'm crazy. So there's thousands of people looking at me, and you know what my stage was? My bed. That was my bed, right? So what I would do, I had this little system, I would go, the Iron Maiden Killers, first day I came home from school, you guys can follow me on this, put the record on, right at the record, right, it's on, all of a sudden, Killer starts, right? So this is after I learned the song, so when I was really comfortable with it, right? I go up, I said, how am I gonna do this? I just learned the first bass part, I finally learned the first bass part, so right away, it's stage time. Stage time meaning, Madison Square Garden sold out in my room, right? This lights up everywhere, right? The lighters, people cheering. I'm 13, 14 years old, right? This is me though, right? So I go on my bed, all of a sudden, put the record on, all of a sudden. In my head, I can't even hear the music anymore because people are going nuts. And you want to know my big move? Here's my big move off my bed. Right, check this out. My big stage jump. Right, all of a sudden. Then when the song actually starts, yeah, off my bed. Fuck yeah. But this is the creative stuff. That little thing right there got me to the next point where I wanted to do more, and I would go to the next stage. I would go to the next song and learn that song and keep playing it. You know, I remember, oh God, Rothschild. Oh my God, I couldn't, it was a bass intro. Yes, you know, I could do all this and live through this. And I'll be honest, I was Steve Harris. In my mind, I was Steve Harris. Again, we're going back. This is the hero that inspired me. This, and instead of going the route where a lot of kids can go, and unfortunately do go, you know, you grow up and you can go two routes. You can go the college way, you know, or you can go the drug way, right? Unfortunately, that's what it is. I didn't have enough money for college, right? So music was my tunnel vision thing. It was that's what kept me going. All my friends would come to the deli I worked in on Friday nights. I remember this. They would come to the deli I worked in. Hey, you coming out to the club tonight? Yeah, they were all buying drugs and, you know, yeah, we're gonna go. I said, really? Yeah, and we're all gonna get girls and stuff like that. And I'm thinking, I have to learn Drifter from the Iron Maiden record. There's no way I'm going out with you tonight. There's no way that's gonna, you are not stopping me from learning that. So I'm so happy that I actually chose that this was more important than that, because all these guys, and look, no disrespect to anybody who wants to do that, right? But a lot of these guys now who did the drugs and were partying with girls are all very unhappy and have people they're married to they don't like, you know what I mean? And they got the girls pregnant very early. You know what I mean? I don't want that. And my bass is so much more important than that, you know? It's like, I have a kid now because I waited. I waited way, way till I was established and all that good stuff. I just think music has a lot more for life. And it could save a lot more, you know, just what you're doing. Just save your shit, man. Just, there's so many distractions. Get back into music, man. It'll lead you the way. And I want to push that forward. It really is important to me. I see what's going on. I have a 10-year-old who plays a lot of video games. We were talking about this before. What I like to do, I don't want to force. I said, here, play this bass. No, you can't do that. We all know that's not going to work. What I do is play in front of him all the time. And all of a sudden, you know, I'll see from the corner, picks up the guitar once in a while, just starts strumming it. That's what I want, organic. It comes organically. It's very important to happen like that, right? So, all right, so that's we're all going, I know I'm going a lot of different places right now, but I want to tell you everything. So this is my upbringing. So, okay, we did Cotton Amash. Now I'm going to go back a little bit to this spreading the disease thing. You have to understand, I got an anthrax at 17 years old. I was playing for 4 years. 4 years I was playing bass, and I got in a band on a major label. Woo! Major label, which is garbage these days. I can't describe what kind of fear that is, because this song I'm going to play for you from Spreading the Disease was my first song I recorded on that record. I remember going in with the producer, Carl Kennedy. I was shaking. I was shaking because major label, I was in the band Anthrax now. I knew the song. I thought I knew the song, but I also just threw in everything I could. And you'll hear it on this song. There's Steve Harris in the song. There's Geezer Butler, and there's definitely some Getty. You'll hear more, probably Steve Harris more than anybody. But what else could I do? This is what I knew. So I just brought whatever the sponge of my brain that's been growing as a bass player, I put it all into this song. So after this song, you guys watch this song, you watch the parts. You tell me if you notice some Steve Harris, some Geezer Butler, and some Getty. I guarantee you will. But it's funny, but I mean it as a compliment. It's not that I'm ripping them off. This is all I knew. And I find it funny because I'm going through this right now, and it was all about that. So this is, oh God, this is a song called Lone Justice, okay? Off right now, by the way, just putting it out there. That's fun. You guys know that song, so obviously, yeah, it was just cool. Again, you know what? Know what happens after all this time and reflecting, playing that song? Music, when you write songs and you have records, they're a scrapbook of your life, is what happens. Looking back, playing that song, each time I play that song, if I do a clinic, if we do live sometimes, I remember that day I was in the studio being so intimidated. Yes, you have a question, sir.
Yes, please. On the album, it always says Anthrax has written it.
Yeah.
And you're saying, no, I've written it.
No, I don't take credit for it. Anthrax is a band that writes all the songs together. Yeah, I don't personally write. I'm just one of the writers in Anthrax. I put that really out there. It's no one person writes all the songs. We write to collective. I don't think Anthrax could work if we all didn't work together. Even Charlie writes a lot of great riffs. Scott writes lyrics. I write a lot of the melodies. Joey's just a great vocalist. I mean, it just really works as a band. There's no the ego thing is out the window because we know this works. It's been working for a while.
And regarding the lyrics?
And regarding the lyrics, yeah, Scott writes the lyrics. He's been doing it since day one, and he's great at it. So if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? That's just the truth, yeah. So thank you for the question. Any other questions? Yeah, so I'll go back to that. again, 17 years old, and here's the crazy thing. In New York, where I grew up, I went to this place, Lehman High School. My school was Lehman High School in high school. I was 16 and a half, 17, and I remember I got in the band. I auditioned for the band. I heard I got it. I was in the band Anthrax. Now I had to finish high school. I was in my senior year. How was I going to do this? 12th grade. I can't leave high school. I'm not going to get the education. I want to finish it. Always. I'm not going to do the band. So what I did was I graduated. You know, we had credits. We had credits for each day, each semester. I doubled up my credits. So I would start earlier in the day, in the morning, and end around 4:30, 5 o'clock at night to double up my credits so I can graduate 6 months early. Just to get in the band. So they owe me, these bastards. Just thinking about that, how hard that was. Yeah, I kid, but it was a great feat to do that, because I did a lot of studying and all that stuff, but I thought the payoff of Anthrax, being in the band, they were going to go on tour. How was I going to do this? I'm not leaving school. So I did that, and then it's a crazy thing. 17 years old, graduate, finishing that, going into the studio, that scrapbook of my life, playing that song. That was the first song I recorded on Spreading the Disease. That's why I remember, Carl Kennedy is the producer on that record. Now, this is how I came into the studio that day for first day of recording. I swear to God, this happened. I was like this. I plugged in. Right? Everything was shaky. My hands would not stay still. So I was like this. And he sees me like this, right? And he hears it. He goes, "Oh, Frank, relax." And I swear to God, he goes in the kitchen, and this is what he does. And this is why I bring this out. Drink this. Drink this. It was a shot of whiskey. And that's why. And he says, and I swear, man, I did the gulp. I was 17. I didn't drink. It's like, all of a sudden, my throat was on fire. That took my mind off of everything else, right? That's all I could worry about. How my throat's burning up. What the hell is that, right? So I took the sip. And like now, everything is fine. See? It's all good. And then I plugged in. And then I started the song. And sorry about that. I'm very professional, obviously. Sorry about that. And then I just started. And then, you know what? It really became like, just calm down. Just play. And that's why that word play is so important to me. Just play. You're just playing. You're not a brain surgeon. You're not causing, you're not solving cancer. I wish everybody would. I wish somebody would. But my thing is, this is just playing. You're supposed to enjoy it. That's why when I see other clinicians like, "Oh, look at this scale, I do," and all of a sudden this young kid about 14 years old who's thinking about playing, go, "Oh, I can't do that." No, you don't do that. You want to tell them, here, do this major scale. Do that, start slow. Give me an E first. Do that, you start slow and you build day to day. That's how you do it. That's for me, that means more. When I was young, that would have meant more than being intimidated. That's the truth. So let's go back to technique. If people ask me about my technique and how did I learn and all this good stuff, let's start. How do you get your speed with your fingers? We have any finger bass players here? We unite. I love this. I love that. I have no problem with picks, because I'll do a pick thing in a little while too. But my thing was, again, you remember my heroes, Steve, Getty. I call him by first name. Isn't that so cool? Steve, Getty, Geezer, my buddies. You know? So. I'm so pathetic. Really. I'm very lucky enough to play with them. But you have to understand, when I talk to them, I'm Frank when I was 14. So when I talk to Geezer, he's looking at me and laughing and knowing, as, "Would you stop?" And Steve, the same way. Steve was still. I know him a lot of years now, so just. But I don't want to lose that fanboy thing, you know. I think it's important to keep that and put these guys where they belong, on a pedestal, because they're the best in my book. They're the best, and they always will be. So I think, why not give them tribute? So let's go back to technique. The way I learned. You guys know about my bedroom, right? At this point, nobody wants to hear about my bedroom anymore. We know that. So I would just sit down. And the way I started to learn, I would go home from school. Again, it's all about school. You come home from school, sit down. I wanted to learn, like, I wanted to learn Rush. I wanted to learn, how do you do, you know. So I want to wanted to learn that. I was into these songs. I said, how do I learn this? But I couldn't get the, you know, the speed or the tenacity that I needed, the confidence, big time confidence. So what I would do is I wanted to get my fingers strong. They weren't strong because I was playing, you know, like that, you're flopping off the strings. That's how you start. Everybody has to start somewhere. Everybody in this world has to start somewhere. Don't look down on people that are starting, because that's your next brilliant bass player, or it's your next brilliant guitar player or musician. I just believe in building confidence, and that's the truth. So this is how I would start. I started on day one. I would go home, go in my living room, and I put the TV on. I had no amp on, and I would just start playing. I could do it like this, and I would just play one note at a time to develop my one, two. And this was the first day. I remember this. I was just watching some cartoon, Flintstones, I don't know, whatever the hell it was. So I was just, and then I would get daring as I'm watching this. I want to try and get some speed up. Go coordination, two fingers, one, two, one, two, one. Just, and it doesn't have to be too fast. This is building. You just, again, it's a work in motion. One, two, one, two. Then the next day, put the bass down. Next day, you come back to the same thing. You start off with one, two, one, two. And then what I would want to do is build a little speed, right? And all of a sudden, you hear that it's going up a little faster. Tempo's getting a little faster, right? Go back and forth. All of a sudden, there's rhythm there. There's rhythm there. Day to day, this is weeks upon weeks, months upon months. This was my strategy. I'm gonna learn, I'm gonna get strength in my right hand. This is how I'm gonna build this thing. And it worked, because after a couple of months, you know, all of a sudden you go from this, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. See what I mean? You all of a sudden, this is after a lot of works, and I'm not playing as steady as I can, but you just have to just keep building like everything else. If you want it, you have to work for it. You have to work for it. And it's gotta, eventually, you just get there. All of a sudden, I'm looking at some of the same cartoons I was watching, or some of my favorite shows, and I'm like, all of a sudden, I got this thing going. Yeah,